watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
You're watching West Hartford Community Television.
For the community, by the community.
Hello, and welcome to The Foundation Presents. My name is Michael Schramm, and I'm a member of the board of the Foundation for West Hartford Public Schools, an independent nonprofit 501c3 founded in 1997 for the purpose of supplementing and expanding the educational experience beyond the regular school budget. For the last 20 years, the foundation has funded over $1.4 million in grants throughout the West Hartford Public School System. And those programs have included professional in-residence grants, teacher mini grants, supplemental grants for technology, and unique pilot programs. All of these grants have gone to support the curriculum through broad-reaching, creative, innovative experiences beyond the purview of the classroom. Each year, we reach over 200 educators and over 9,000 students and are funded entirely through contributions from local businesses and individuals and families within the West Hartford community. I myself am not only the youngest member of the foundation, but am also a product of the West Hartford public school system and can attest not only to the quality of the educational experience overall, but to the excellence of the educators who make up the backbone of one of the best educational systems in the great state of Connecticut. I'm here today to introduce you to three of those educators who will talk a bit about the grants that they received. I'd like to welcome as our first guest, Kathy Hardesty. She is a Quest teacher at Smith and Norfell Elementary Schools and received a grant Up and Away last year. And Kathy, I'd love if you could talk a bit about what that grant was.
Sure, I'd be happy to. Up and Away is a grant that involved a weather balloon. And what I wanted to do was involve the whole school in something in science and technology and get really every kid excited about what would happen if a weather balloon went up to space. So we attached the weather balloon to this payload that had GoPro cameras on it and a GPS unit.
Oh, great.
And what happened was each classroom was able to watch the GPS unit, the pings from it, as it went up into space.
Oh, great.
So they predicted where it would go. Mm-hmm. They watched the path of the balloon. And then they actually could see it come back down from the stratosphere as far as the signals.
Okay.
And see where it landed.
So it actually did get up into space?
Yes.
Oh, wow. That is so neat. And how did that tie in with the broader curriculum that you were teaching?
Well, we do tie it into the Sun, Earth, Space unit in fifth grade and also geography in fourth grade. But also the inquiry that we like to teach at Smith, having kids wonder and inquire about what is happening. So, you know, just to get everyone involved was really the big idea behind it.
And speaking of getting everyone involved, I'm under the impression that there were high school students who were involved in this program as well.
Yes. There's a tech teacher, his name is Anthony Truss, and he helped us with the initial filling of our balloon. And he had done something similar to this at Conard. So he was able to actually bring a crew of his students over to Smith, and they launched a balloon at the same time as
us
during that. So he was able to help us, but also be mentors for the younger kids to see what the older kids could do with the balloon as well.
And where did the two balloons go?
Well, our first one, we actually did it two times.
Oh, great.
Because we had enough money to have two balloons through the grant. The first one landed in a farm in Spencer, Massachusetts.
Okay.
And it's funny because our payload had a little note on it saying, call us if found.
Yeah.
So they actually called us. We didn't have to go track down
That's great.
The balloon through the GPS.
It's always nice when people cooperate.
The second time, our balloon landed about 200 feet up in a tree near stores and near Yukon. And we had to look for it and get to know the people on the land and try to get to our balloon.
There weren't any intrepid UConn students who climbed up the tree to catch it?
No.
Well, it's probably the best.
And the UConn balloon landed, I mean, I'm sorry, the high school balloon landed somewhere a little bit easier for them to to retrieve.
Oh, that's always nice.
So, yes.
And can you speak a little bit about your interactions with the Foundation for West Harford Public Schools to get this grant funded and then afterward?
Well, I am a teacher liaison, I guess, for Smith, and I always try to come up with ideas for the students and for, and I like to, you know, try to get different teachers and grade levels involved in grants so that it's a little bit more far-reaching. And then just creating the video was great because not only could we share it with our students at Smith so that they could see where the balloon went, because they really had no idea what the pictures would look like, but also the foundation was able to use the video to share with their supporters and and broader audience.
It's always nice when we can tell a nice story to our donors.
Yes.
And I'm under the impression that you received the grant multiple years, is that correct?
This year we received another more money to do a similar thing. So we renamed the grant Teaching on the Edge. And what we're going to do is actually send up more instrumentation so that it's more scientific. And I have a couple of those things here.
Oh, excellent.
So these are sensors from a company called Vernier.
Okay.
And it's going to look at pressure and temperature as the balloon goes up so that we can show the students what will happen, you know, temperature-wise. And because at a certain level in the stratosphere, the balloon explodes, actually, and then the parachute brings it down. So to show, you know, that graph and to bring a little bit of scientific data, because we are a STEM school, we thought was important this time.
And how did the students respond to the grant?
Oh, they love it. They call me the balloon lady. And they're very excited. And the fact that they heard that we were doing it again, you know, they just can't stop talking about it.
Great.
And we're really trying to get more more kids involved this time through this and testing this equipment, and also through writing stories of prediction and maybe even after what happens with the balloon. We're also considering sending up a minifigure that one of the cameras will be focused on during the trip. So, you know, bring in a little Lego as
Yeah, that'd be nice. And how many students were involved in this?
Well, it's a whole school grant. So, you know, I mean, I like to say all of
it's
the kids,
in,
you know, 350 kids. There are certain kids from fifth grade and fourth grade that help a little bit more with the setting up of the payload and testing the equipment.
Okay. And then how many kids from the high school came over to help?
It was about 10, I think.
And did they interact with the elementary school kids at all? Or were they more on their
own? The kids were able to ask them questions about what they had done. Because we were up on the roof and the high school kids were down on the field with the kids, so they were able to talk to them.
Okay, I'm sure that the kids loved that.
Yes.
Being able to see the older kids.
And we hope to have them here in the spring as well. So I've reached out to them.
Yeah. And do you work directly with the teacher at Conard?
Yes.
Or is that
Yes.
That's great.
And we also have we go to see him through our computer club once a year as well. So we have kind of a just a relationship that we've built between Smith and Conard.
Great. And was this grant the first grant that you applied for from the foundation, or have you been involved with the foundation in the past?
Yeah, I've been doing it for about 10 years.
Great.
And probably received over $25,000 in grants.
Oh, wow, that's awesome.
Yes. One of our big ones was a video conferencing grant, which we shared with Charter Oak. It was one of the $10,000 grants that were sent out.
Great.
So that was really exciting, being able to bring video conferencing to Smith.
Yeah.
And also I do a lot with robotics. And in fact, this weekend, one of the grants I received, we are doing, which is we have a robot that is entering the Trinity Firefighting Robot Contest.
Oh, awesome.
And what it has to do is go through this maze and find a candle and put it out. And we call it Smokey, and we have a wet sponge on our robot that hopefully will hit the flame and
hopefully.
Put it out.
We don't want to have any big fires.
Yes.
And that's at Trinity College, right? Right
in
Hartford?
Yes, on Saturday.
Excellent.
Yes.
Excellent. Yeah.
So that was one of the grants I received this year.
Okay, great. So you've received multiple grants in the same year?
Yes.
That's great.
Yeah, teachers are can write up to three grants.
Okay.
And I like to write two or three grants that involve different schools and different groups of people. And, you know, if I get one, then I'm happy. If I get three, then I'm busy.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And this year I got three, so.
Yeah, well, there we go. We'll keep you nice and busy.
Yes.
And do any of those grants happen at Norfelt, too, or they all just happen to be at Smith this year?
It just happened to be this year. Last year I received one that had to do with graphing calculators, and I used it at both schools.
Okay.
So.
Great. So it sounds like this is a great way for the students just to be exposed to something else that there otherwise wouldn't be a budget for.
Yes, and something sort of exciting that ties into the curriculum that, you know, they may not expect.
Yeah.
Because, you know, just to see the excitement of the kids when there's a new project that, you know, that they can really build up to.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Is the best.
Well, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate you coming on here and telling me about your experience with the foundation.
Thank you.
Next, I'd like to welcome Ryan Cleary, the principal of Morley Elementary School. Now, Ryan, you were the recipient of one of our special initiatives grants, and I'd love for you to talk a little bit about that.
Absolutely. So we were very excited to receive the special initiatives grant, and the grant is called Producing 21st Century Global Citizens and Artists. Mm-hmm. And it all kind of came to be because we were thinking about ways where we could teach students at Morley School about different cultures, mm-hmm. where they could see the world through the eyes of a student when the world looked a lot different than it did in the Morley neighborhood.
Yeah.
So we happen to have a connection with a group called the Crosby Foundation, mm-hmm. who does a lot of work to support education in Haiti.
Okay.
And the grant is all about creating a relationship with a sister school in mm-hmm. Deschapelles, Haiti,
okay.
where our students have a chance to interact with students there and learn about how each of their school days operate.
Okay.
And one of the things that we thought about right away was the language barrier, mm-hmm. because the students in Haiti speak Creole.
Yeah, absolutely.
And of course, we speak English, so we thought that the universal language we would like to use would be art, because it's visual, it's a great way for students to express themselves.
Yeah.
So the grant is set up in a way that we basically do an art exchange over the course of the year.
Uh-huh.
So our students take some of the regular art projects that they do in their curriculum, mm-hmm. they create that art, and then they also create videos and directions, mm-hmm. and then we gather materials and send all of that down to Haiti so that the Haitian students can recreate the art that we do here at Morley.
Okay.
And then there'll be an exchange where the Haitian students will do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
They'll create some of the art that they do, mm-hmm. and they will send it to us, and then we will try to recreate that at Morley School as well.
Now, how did that supplement the current curriculum that was being taught already?
Sure. Well, it supplemented it in a couple different ways. And the first and the most obvious way is through the art curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
So we were able to have the students not just go through the art curriculum, but have to explain it to somebody else, which brings them to a deeper level of understanding.
Mm-hmm.
Additionally, there are social studies standards that we tied in.
Okay.
One of the obvious ones being geography and looking at, you know, where Haiti is in relationship to West Hartford, Connecticut.
Sure.
But also geography in terms of civics and what it means to be a citizen, in this case, a global citizen, and what it means, again, to learn about different cultures.
Mm-hmm.
And then lastly, too, a lot of what we've done has taken place in the library. As students have done research about Haiti, so they've built some background knowledge.
Okay.
And so a lot of our work has also aligned nicely with the research standards and curriculum in the library.
And has this been students from all over the school or one particular grade or a particular class?
It's been far-reaching throughout the entire school.
Okay.
So we have just under 300 students at Morley, and they've all had a chance to participate one way or the other.
Mm-hmm.
Our second graders were the ones who really initiated things with our Eric Carl collage project, which was the first piece we sent down there that kind of got things started for us.
Mm-hmm.
But since then, every grade level in one way or another has had the chance to contribute art, to learn about Haiti, to participate in one way or another, especially in the beginning of the year when Haiti was hit by Hurricane Matthew.
Absolutely.
And, you know, we had just established the relationship. It was fresh in everybody's mind.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of hit our community. And we had a tremendous outpouring from our community and were able to some relief directly to our school in the areas that were affected.
And they were affected by the hurricane?
They were. Fortunately, they were not in the hardest hit part of the island.
Okay, that's great.
But certainly, you know, the village sustained some damage. And
sure.
so, you know, they're appreciative of everything that we can do. And it makes us feel good to know we're helping somebody out.
Yeah. Now, was this the only grant that Morley received in this academic year, or were there others as well?
No, there were four total this year.
Okay.
In fact, one of them is closely connected to this grant.
Oh, great.
Wasn't originally planned to be, but one of the great things about what the foundation does for West Hartford Public Schools is that you get started with something and it grows into something bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So I know there'll be a guest on this show in the near future who'll be able to give you some more details about that.
Well, great. And obviously, Connecticut is in a turbulent time in terms of our budget, and it looks like West Hartford in particular could be on the receiving end of some pretty significant education cuts. And I would love if you could speak a little bit about the foundation's role during these uncertain times and then on into the future.
Sure. Well, the thing about the budget situation is it is a challenge. It's a challenge for a lot of districts, and it's a challenge for us. One of the things that has come through loud and clear at all of the meetings, the public forums, whether it be with the town council or with the Board of Education, has been that West Hartford is a district that is known across the state of Connecticut, across the country, for really going above and beyond, for being a special place that people seek out. Mm-hmm. And the grants that the Foundation for West Hartford Public Schools provide for our teachers and our students mm-hmm. are a perfect example of that. So they take the things that we regularly do mm-hmm. in the curriculum, the things that align with the state standards, and they give us the opportunity to do something just a little bit more,
yeah.
a little bit extra, a little okay. bit deeper, a little mm-hmm. bit more meaningful. And that's a tremendous support for us in a time like this mm-hmm. when, you know, fiscal responsibility is on everybody's mm-hmm. on everybody's mind. So to know that we have a group like the Foundation who supports learning mm-hmm. To a real deep level and learning beyond what's expected in the classroom is fantastic. Mm-hmm. And it has a profound impact on our students.
Yeah.
When I think about what's happened with our grant this year, I think about the look in our students' faces mm-hmm. when we get a video back from Haiti and they see, for example, self-portraits they did not long ago. Mm-hmm. So they see the actual self-portraits that they drew in class, and they see in a video students in Deschapelle, Haiti, holding yeah. up those self-portraits and using those as a model
yeah.
as they then go and create theirs. Mm-hmm. And you know, then when we see that in the reverse and we get artwork back from Haiti mm-hmm. and we learn that, you know, until we sent scissors down there, the students in that school had never used scissors before.
Wow.
And to see that come alive for kids mm-hmm. and to see them make a cultural connection mm-hmm. from so far away, all of a sudden we're not thinking about budget anymore.
Yeah.
We're back in the place where we should be, mm-hmm. which is focused on student learning.
That's great. And I think that this grant in particular is very prescient, given that arts funding is some of the first funding that gets cut when there are budget cutbacks, and obviously the sciences and STEM in general are extremely important for the development of a child, mm-hmm. but it would seem to me that funding for the arts as well is equally important, not only for children to be able to learn how to communicate things without speaking, but also to be able to communicate cross-culturally like that. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's really important that you mention that the students that are down in the sister school don't speak English, and obviously the students in Morley don't speak Creole, and the fact that they can still communicate with one another across that language barrier, I think is a really touching story that can go out to the broader West Hartford community. But I'm curious if there's any other lessons that you've learned from this that you'd love to share with me and with the broader town community.
Well, I think the biggest thing really is a lot of what you had to say in that one of the things I love most about this grant is that it is interdisciplinary. Mm-hmm. I mean, you go everything from library research skills to art learning to the social studies. And, you know, at Morley School, as with all the schools in West Hartford, we teach to the whole child. Mm-hmm. And everything is a priority because every student in our school district has unique talents. And the Foundation, through their grant work, provides us the opportunity to let kids really develop those talents and become who they are, whether that's from an artistic point of view, whether it's from an academic point of view, whether it's linguistic, whether mm-hmm. it's something they excel at in physical education. Mm-hmm. You know, there's an avenue for every child. And I guess the biggest thing I've learned is that the Foundation for West Hartford Public Schools just provides that opportunity for us to learn more about our kids.
Yeah.
Because when we write a grant like this and we give students a chance to express themselves in a variety of different ways, they really rise to the occasion. Mm-hmm. And we find that grants grow and they reach much farther than we originally intended, which is exactly where we are right now.
Absolutely. Well, Ryan, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you very much for having me.
And now I'd like to welcome Sarah Lynch, a library media specialist at Walcott Elementary School.
And I should explain that means that I am a school librarian, because a lot of people get very confused about that title, right?
Great.
They think media specialist, they think you work with NBC or CBS.
Okay, yeah, great. I'm glad you explained that. That was a very vague title, and I'm glad that we have a little more clarity on that.
I am a school librarian.
Now, can you speak a little bit about the grant that you received?
Yes, so the title of my grant was The Year I Met an Author. Mm-hmm. We brought in Grace Lynn. She's a New York Times bestselling author and mm-hmm. illustrator, actually, award-winning.
Okay.
We specifically wanted to have her come in. Mm-hmm. We did a whole day, so it was an author in residence. Okay. There's a specific category of the grant, so there's different types, and okay. one of them is an author artist in residence. Okay. So she was there for the entire school day. On the actual day of the event, Grace visited with grades K through 5. She talked about everything from how she became a published writer and the process that the book goes through. She also talked about the inspiration for writing her books. She shared a few specific stories from her childhood that are also included in the books. The other part is that she did a draw along with every grade level. So all grade levels had kids brought in a piece of paper. They actually drew right along with her, and she talked about the cultural significance behind some of her artwork. So as shown in this tiger drawing, she talked about the Chinese symbols of power and how that related to the items in the illustration.
And why specifically Grace Lynn?
So Grace Lynn, I, myself and one other teacher in the school were talking about having an author, and mm-hmm. I said, if we do that, I really want to make sure that I have a diverse author. Mm-hmm. So Grace Lynn is Asian American. Her parents were from Taiwan.
Okay.
And we wanted to make sure that we had exposure to diverse authors because mm-hmm. I try as a librarian to make sure that I have a diverse set of books in the library. But one thing I started to notice even in other schools is they were always having a white male author.
Sure.
And I began to think that that really wasn't reflective of my community. Mm-hmm. At our school at Walcott, we yeah. have 16% that are Asian American students. So okay. that's our highest minority population.
Okay.
The district as a whole obviously has a lot of students mm-hmm. that are Asian American. Mm-hmm. So that allowed those students to have not just they have an author, that's great, but they had a specific window into their experience, mm-hmm. right? That they see, oh, there's this model, this role model, and she's like me.
Yeah. That must have been so nice. I remember growing up myself reading lots of kids' books, and like you said, most of the characters and the authors were white men, and it was nice to see somebody who looked like me on the page. And I'm sure that some of the students in your classroom appreciated that.
Yeah.
Now, can you tell me a bit about the specifics of the grant?
So before I do that, I do okay. want to explain that when we started looking at that, when mm-hmm. we started writing the grant, because
yeah.
obviously the grant writing process, it's long.
Sure.
It is a long application, but we bounced off ideas and mm-hmm. wanted to make sure that it wasn't just, like I said, oh, we're going to have another author.
Yeah.
Other schools do that.
Okay.
I wanted to do something different.
Great.
So I started researching and looked at why we would have a diverse author. Mm-hmm. And one thing was that I started reading an article that was published in the Saturday Review. Mm-hmm. It was published in 1965, and it
okay.
was titled The All-White World of Children's Books.
Hmm.
And it revealed out of the 5,206 children's trade books published by 63 publishers that only 349 books, or about 6.7%, had one or more African-American character in them.
Wow.
Eight of the publishers at that time published only all-white books.
Wow.
Okay, so that's 1965.
Sure.
You're thinking, whatever, no big deal, mm-hmm. things are better
50 years
now.
Of progress.
Yes, we're great. That's when I started in the research. I read multicultural publisher Lee and Lowe Books.
Mm-hmm.
They specifically do only multicultural books.
Oh, okay.
And they have tracked from 1994 to current day, but the data that I had at the time was 2013.
Okay.
So over 18 years, mm-hmm. they tracked people of color in the United States, the population versus people of color in children's books.
Okay.
And that remained at about 10% of children's books published annually.
Wow.
Yes, had a contained multicultural context, mm-hmm. so a character of color.
Wow.
Or a different culture.
So slight improvement over 1965, but marginal at best.
Yes, and in 2013, 30% mm-hmm. of the population in the U.S. are people of color.
Sure.
So there's a
yeah,
huge disparity.
Absolutely.
So I noticed and I said, we really need to make sure that I make a concerted effort.
Mm-hmm.
Because even though I'm bringing those books in the library, they're still not a large portion mm-hmm. of our resources.
Yeah. And how did the students respond to that?
So we had a lot of students who, when I first announced who it was, mm-hmm. I saw, they said, where's she from? Mm-hmm. And that really melded well with our curriculum okay. because the part of the piece to, part of the piece to prepare for the grant mm-hmm. was to have myself, the art teacher, and the classroom teachers all working as a team, not okay. just they're preparing in library or they're preparing in the classroom.
Yeah.
So the students, the teachers read her books in the classroom.
Okay.
They did all of novels as a read aloud, all class read aloud. So okay. every student in the school was exposed to her books prior to the
Great.
Visit, which made a huge difference.
I'm sure.
But at that point, I started explaining to them, mm-hmm. okay, what do you notice about the culture? It's different. Mm-hmm. Let's look in and research some about her mm-hmm. in library. So we researched her, we researched Taiwanese and Chinese culture as
okay.
well as just the countries.
Yeah.
Because some of the students had no frame of reference,
mm-hmm.
but we
I'm
had
sure.
students at school who were from there and they started
oh, wow.
going. They would start in the middle of my thing,
yeah.
go, I know about that. I know. I eat that food.
Wow.
I, you know, have been there.
Yeah.
My grandparents are from there. So that was
what a great way of engaging the students. And
yeah.
and did was it a positive response overall from all the students or
Yeah, because I had lots of students
great.
Who knew nothing about that culture prior
sure.
to this.
Yeah.
So I think that that was really, really huge. And they mm-hmm. started then saying turning to their friends in their class
mm-hmm.
and asking them more because they may know more,
yeah.
obviously being from that culture themselves.
And then Grace, the author, came to the school?
Yes, so we did all that prep work. They also connected in the art classroom. I forgot to explain that.
Okay.
The art teacher used her because she's an author and an illustrator. That
oh,
was
okay.
the big piece. So
yeah.
it wasn't just that it was her writing, but her
okay.
artwork.
Mm-hmm.
So she creates picture books. And even in her chapter books, she has huge full-page, beautiful, detailed illustrations.
Wow.
I showed those to my art teacher. She was actually a new art teacher last school year.
Okay.
So we had written the grant the year before, and she was not there.
Oh, wow.
So she was kind of thrown into it, and I said, hey,
trial by
look
fire.
At these. I need you to connect with me.
Yeah.
So she taught the specific techniques, and
mm-hmm.
I cannot go into those techniques because that's not my area
and
of expertise.
I won't ask you to do so.
But the art teacher definitely went through, and she actually, the awesome part is she loved using Gracelyn's work in
mm-hmm.
her unit so much that she's using it again this year.
Oh, excellent.
So
that's great. And was this your only experience with the foundation?
No. A few years ago, I also received another grant that was it purchased audiobooks for reluctant readers.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. Great. So you've interacted with the foundation before, and it seems like some of the stuff that we've enabled you to do in the classroom has touched a lot of students in ways that normally wouldn't have happened in the base curriculum.
Definitely. I mean, a story I like to tell is at the end of the day, Gracelyn was doing the book signings,
mm-hmm.
and I had a couple of students in there, and they were Asian American,
mm-hmm.
and they had been talking, you know, oh, I cannot believe she's like me and she's here,
mm-hmm.
and that she's a famous author. And when I have a photograph of a student who got her book signed, talked to her, you know, but I could tell she didn't want to leave.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, okay, well, we have to keep going with the line, but
mm-hmm.
you can kind of stand over here. And there's a picture of her actually just kind of standing, looking with a smile on her face. And that's how she was the whole time. She was watching Grace and was like, maybe I can do that one
Excellent.
Day.
Excellent. Well, Sarah Lynch, thank you so much for coming on. I appreciate your time.
Thank you. I appreciate you giving the time to explain my grant.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for joining us this evening to hear about three of the grants that were funded by the foundation. Those were only three of the 67 grants that were funded overall for a total of $84,000. If you would like to support the foundation, go to www.fwhps.org. It's a great cause. I hope you'll support it. And tune in next month for another edition of The Foundation Presents.